Welcome to worship with the Universalist Unitarian Church of Peoria. My name is Reverend Jennifer Innis, and it is my great joy to be the minister with this congregation of people of all ages, at all stages of life, in all the seasons of our lives as well. We are so glad that you are here to join us this morning, to take this day and this opportunity to gather in community, to share joy and comfort and the challenges of life. For we are an intentional community gathered around our shared promise to support each other's spiritual journeys. So let us worship together, all gender identities, sexual orientations, abilities, racial and ethnic identities, politics, and may we root ourselves in the values of this faith of compassion and courage, transcendence, justice, transformation, and service. And as we are rooted in our relationships, we recognize our connections with our neighbors and with this land. For this is the ancestral home of the Peoria people. They were here long before the white Europeans came down the Illinois River. And so we offer our respect every time we gather in worship. We offer our respect for the Peoria people, for who they were and for who they are today. And I especially would like to welcome any guests that are joining us today. Thank you for taking a chance and taking the time to come through our doors, whether in person or online, and join us for this service, for this is one of the most important hours in this beloved community where we offer stories, where we sing, where we share bits of each other's lives, where we offer that spiritual challenge to each other as well. So please help us get to know you better by wearing a name tag, saying hello with one of our greeters, filling out a visitor card. And I want to invite you, if you're joining us in person, that we have a newcomers table in Fellowship Hall, which is a great way to get to know people as well. And if you're joining us online, please stay after during the Zoom to get to know folks there as well. And now part of how we gather, in addition to greeting and getting to know one another, is that we put our respective devices into worship mode. This is a great moment to pause and say, did I actually do that today? Yes. In case you're wondering, we also have a ministry of helping with the devices if you need that as well, either buzzy or silent. And also, in the spirit of accessibility, if you find that you need a hearing assist device in the course of the morning, please, by all means, we have those and see one of the ushers or greeters for that as well. And now I want to invite, just give a preview of next Sunday will be, that'll be the first Sunday of the month. It'll be the month that we begin in talking about the theme of vulnerability. But also for the first service, we'll be looking at our core language in Unitarian Universalism around our values, our principles, what we hold most dear, and how do we convey that into the world. And it's in the form that we're doing that in this moment by looking at our Unitarian Universalist Association bylaws. I know, bylaws, yes, we love the bylaws. In this case, we love the bylaws because it really does talk about our values and how we present ourselves and how we commit ourselves to one another. So it's a very important conversation. So join us for the service to hear what's kind of part two of our Brave New Words conversation, and also stay after the service for a discussion as well. And now I'd like to invite you to rise in body or spirit and join me for our opening hymn number 131, Love Will Guide Us. We will listen once and then sing through all the verses. Please be seated. Let me invite Jean Jost forward to offer our opening words for today.
Good morning, everyone. Good morning. It's good to see everyone. This morning, we're going to have words from Libby D. Stoddard. And it's called, We Have Come Into This Room of Hope. And as you will see, we don't stay in the room of hope. We move on. We have come into this room of hope where our hearts and minds are opened to the future. We have come into this room of justice, where we set aside our fear to name freely every oppression. We have come into this room of love, where we know that no lives are insignificant. We have come into this room of song, where we unite our voices in the somber and the beautiful melodies of life.
And let me invite Abby and Nate Price forward to offer our chalice lighting.
Let us look first to the response of love by Rev. Maureen
Killoran.
In these hard times, let us look first to the response of love.
In the midst of challenge, may our chalice flame bear witness to the inherent worth and dignity of every human being.
In the midst of uncertainty, may our chalice be a beacon of encouragement, that our values may guide our choices.
Let us look first to the response of love.
For those of you who are visitors today, those are mine, and I am theirs. There we are. It is so much as an expression of love that we offer a bit of the generosity of our lives into the world. In this spirit, we recognize the act of giving in the course of worship because it is so important to recognize and do so intentionally. And it's such a gift to be able to offer something of our lives in the company of others. It is no small thing to offer that extension of self and to say, yes, this is where I will place what I love and where my life is. And we also do that not only for the sustained ministries of this congregation, of which the congregation is a self-supporting body. It really is each of us adding a little something to make this whole congregation and its ministries possible. But we also take a bit of that generosity and send it out into the world to do good things. And so we practice sharing our plate. All the undesignated contributions that we offer, that we receive in the course of Sunday service is split between the congregation and the designated organization for that month, as named and outlined by the Social Impact Committee. So this month's Share the Plate recipient is CASA, the Court-Appointed Special Advocates of the 10th Judicial District. These advocates are qualified, compassionate people for the abused and neglected children in our overloaded juvenile court system. Their goal is to see that each child is placed into a safe and permanent home. And I know it's been such a pleasure over the years to get to know people who are these advocates and how much of a ministry it is to the people who are doing this and how much it means in the life of one child and another child and another. So please be generous with your contributions. If you can indicate, if you are making a donation, please indicate the purpose of it on your check or on the envelope. If you're using one of the envelopes, we have a couple of different designations for that. It could be for your pledge. It could be for the share the plate. It could be split between the church and the recipient. And I want to offer again the thanks for all the giving that comes into the congregation that truly makes this community possible. And we are the recipients of all that has been given in the past. And what we give today is the foundation of what will come into tomorrow. So now the ushers will pass the plate. And after the plates have been gone through during our music for meditation, I invite you to come forth and light candles of joy, sorrow, names, and milestones as we gather during our music. And we have the ushers come forward. Let us begin. Thank you. Spirit of community in which we share and find strength and common purpose. We turn our minds and hearts toward one another, bringing into our circle of care all who are celebrating and magnifying joy, all who need our love and support, those who are ill, those who are in pain, either in body or spirit, those who are lonely or have been wronged. I want to begin in the moment where we are sharing the joys and sorrows of the congregation with a joy from Reverend Marcus Foliano. Reverend Marcus is bringing warm greetings to us from the Chicago Area Unitarian Universalist Council and the Unitarian Universalist Church of Rockford, Illinois, for whom they had the pleasure of joining for conference and service earlier this month. Thank you for bringing greetings from Rockford. And now we turn to our wishes for health. We offer first to Mary Mahalan Kafar, who is currently hospitalized at OSF. And this is a moment if visitors are welcome and probably preferred instead of calls at this moment. Now we turn to sorrow. We offer our heartfelt sympathy to Lynn and Ed Hoffman, as they mourn the loss of Lynn's uncle, Jerry Miller, who is age 99. He was from Quincy, Illinois. He passed the week of February 12th. We offer our sympathy and condolences to Lynn, to Ed, and to all who knew Jerry. We also gather in sorrow with the Lindsay family, BJ and Terrence and Ross and many more, as they mourn the loss of Owen. Owen Lindsay died suddenly on February 23rd. He was unresponsive at his residential facility and was unable to be revived at the hospital. Owen was a young man with a great heart, and his death is very much unexpected, is a deep shock to all who knew him and all who know the Lindsay family. And I want to recognize, we tried to send out notice about Owen's death earlier this week, and that hearing by email and social media is rather blunt, not great. And it's also so important to be able to share this as quickly as possible. So I want to recognize that we keep trying to do well by each other and letting each other know what's going on. If it would be helpful, I know this is quite a shock for many of us, that I am entirely happy to be on the phone or gathering or coffee if that would be helpful. Please feel free to reach out. Thank you. And we'll know more about plans for Owen's memorial as soon as they come together. In our immediate, as well as in our larger world, so much recent anti-trans legislature in Oklahoma and elsewhere is threatening to deny access to health care and increase personal risk to adults and youth. The Unitarian Universalist Association Side with Love campaign reminds us that at a moment when so many legislatures are debating hateful laws, that our faith affirms what is true yesterday, today, and every day, that trans people are divine. There is no such thing as other people's children. and that we all join together in fighting for a world in which all of us are free and thriving. And I offer a similar affirmation to folks who are Black, Indigenous, and people of color who experience oppression every day as well. That all people are divine, and that we join together. Let us offer one more moment of shared quiet for all the joys and sorrows, the names, the presences that are among us and are unspoken. Let us be present to this moment, this one moment we know we have. Please join me in the shared quiet and breathe. We are a part of the web of life that makes us one with all humanity, one with all the universe. We are grateful for the miracle of the consciousness we share, the consciousness that gives us the power to remember, to love, and to care. Let us be grateful for this moment and for going forth. Amen and shalom. Now, let us enter into our story offered by Jesse Lachlan.
Good morning. Good morning. Our story this morning is about Frances Harper. And she is the woman on the cover of your order of service. Frances Harper bends the arc. Sometimes freedom is a long time coming. It may take generations upon generations for justice to be won. Our Unitarian ancestor, Reverend Theodore Parker, said, this and many more words. I do not pretend to understand the moral universe. The arc is a long one, but from what I see, I am sure that it bends toward justice. Those words might sound familiar. They're ones that Reverend Martin Luther King Jr. often used. And later, Barack Obama, the 44th president of the United States and first African-American president, added, but here's the thing. It does not bend on its own. It bends because each of us, in our own ways, put our hands on that arc and bend it in the direction of justice. The hands of Unitarian Universalists have been bending that arc for many, many years. You've heard of John Adams, Susan B. Anthony, Christopher Reeve, and Rachel Carson. Have you heard of Frances Ellen Watkins Harper? Her hand was on the arc too. Harper was born a free Black woman in Baltimore, Maryland, in 1825. She was raised in the household of her uncle, an African Methodist Episcopal minister. He was an abolitionist, a person who objected to the enslavement of Africans. Harper followed her uncle's footsteps to become an educator and abolitionist. She also became a writer, publishing her first book of poetry at 20 years old. and publishing the first short story by an African-American woman later in her life. She often urged Blacks, women, and people in oppressed groups to take a firm stand for equality. In 1850, the Fugitive Slave Act was passed, and it became dangerous to be a free Black person in Maryland because slave owners could claim that you were a runaway slave and force you into slavery. So, Harper moved further north to Ohio, then Philadelphia, and she taught and ran part of the Underground Railroad and lectured around the country, all to bend that arc toward justice. In 1863, abolitionists celebrated success with the passage of the Emancipation Proclamation. Now, this did not immediately create a world where African Americans were treated equally and fairly, but it did make slavery illegal. Harper saw there was still work to be done, so she put her hands to the women's civil rights movement, in particular, the rights of Black women and the right of all women to vote. She founded the National Association of Colored Women, and again, she toured and she lectured and she wrote. She spoke for the need of women to be free, to be more than wives and mothers, and she understood what she was talking about. As a mother herself, after her husband died, Frances Harper took her daughters with her on her lectures. During her justice work, Harper met many Unitarians, also all working to bend the arc. She felt at home in our liberal religious faith, and knew that her work could strengthen the justice work of the Unitarians. So she joined hands with them by joining the First Unitarian Church in Philadelphia in 1870. She frequently read her poetry from the pulpit at that church, yet kept her membership and taught Sunday school at the AME church too. Harper died in 1911 before the 19th Amendment gave women the right to vote in 1919. This was a cause she worked hard to bring about. Yet Harper understood that her labors might not bring about freedoms, might bring about freedoms she would never enjoy. She said, "Apparent failure may hold in its rough shell the germ of success that will blossom in time and bear fruit throughout eternity." Some of the fruits of Harper's labor, the labor of other Unitarian Universalists, are enjoyed by us today. Yet, we are not done. Oppression still exists in our world. Our hands are needed to take their place. May the bending continue until victory is won. I wonder where your hands will be on the ark and how you will help it bend. And now the children can join me. We'll head to the RE Commons.
So we've heard some of Frances Harper's story. What I want to offer in this service are as many of her words as possible, so we really hear her voice in this moment. So in the reading, we will hear that voice against the enslavement of people. The poem is Bury Me in a Free Land. It was written in the for the anti-slavery Bugle newspaper for 1858. And the poem was read in our time, in this moment, in Anna DuVernay's film August 28th, A Day in the Life of a People, as part of the 2016 opening events of the Smithsonian's National Museum of African American History and Culture. So here is Bury Me in a Free Land. You may make my grave wherever you will, in lowly vale or lofty hill. You may make it among earth's humblest graves, but not in a land where men are slaves. I could not sleep if around my grave I heard the steps of a trembling slave. His shadow above my silent tomb would make it a place of fearful gloom. I could not rest if I heard the tread of coffle gang to the shambles led, and the mother's shriek of wild despair rise like a curse on the trembling air. I could not rest if I heard the lash drinking her blood at each fearful gash and saw her babies torn from her breast like trembling doves of the parent from the parent nest. I'd shudder and start if I heard the bay of bloodhounds seizing their human prey, if I heard the captive plead in vain as they tightened afresh his galling chain, if I saw young girls from their mother's arms bartered and sold for their youthful charms, my eye would flash with mournful flame, my death-paled cheek would grow red with shame. I would sleep, dear friends, where bloated might can rob no man of his dearest right. My rest shall be calm in any grave where none calls his brother a slave. I ask no monument, proud and high, to arrest the gaze of passers-by. All that my yearning spirit craves is, bury me not in the land of slaves. Here ends the reading. Please rise in body or spirit for our hymn number 155, Circle Round for Freedom. We will listen once and sing through three times. Please be seated. On May 8th, 1866, with the Civil War over, supporters of the women's suffrage movement gathered at Union Square in Manhattan to help refocus the nation's goal on extending the vote to women. Elizabeth Cady Stanton spoke among others. Now in the reconstruction is opportunity, perhaps of the century, to base our government on the broad principle of equal rights for all. Later that same morning, the lone Black woman in the Speaker's Assembly rose from her seat on the stage and took the podium. Frances Ellen Watkins Harper held her moment and admonished the people so gathered, clarified that what needed to also happen in this work of the vote and equal rights was for the country to be able to treat everybody equally as well, including around concerns of color. She said, "You white women speak here of rights. I speak of wrongs." As we heard from Theodore Parker about that arc of that universe, part of our task is to recover and restore and refresh those who have been bending and those who still need to be with us as we continue our part of that work. And we have a moment for that today to bring Frances Harper into the present, that she may not simply have been part of the past. Because she didn't just challenge the people of her time. Can you imagine the wherewithal it took to get up in front of all those white women just after the Civil War is over and to say, "I'm speaking of wrongs and I'm calling you out on that"? But she did what she had been doing her entire adult life, speaking and speaking and bringing that forth. And so she continues to challenge us today as well as a people of faith, as much as she did in her time, around race and gender and class and voting and what the church says and what the church does. Frances Harper, born Watkins, was born in Maryland in 1825 to free Black parents. And she had, after the terrible, unfortunate early death of her family, she had a remarkable opportunity to be educated at her uncle's school and then go on to work as a domestic in a Quaker family. And that Quaker family had an extensive library, and she did not simply work for them. She was welcome to read anything she wanted. And she did. And with that initiative that seemed both cultivated and, I think, natural to her, she wrote and published, as we said, poetry by the time she was 20. The world around her, of course, kept evolving. So while Maryland had been home, that was no longer a place of safety. And she settled in Ohio and then, as we heard, in Pennsylvania and started to travel to speak against slavery. And Frances was a novelty for this time, this free Black woman traveling by herself in a time when women speaking in public was frowned on. She succeeded and went forth and offered her presence and her oratory and speaking directly about the hardships of enslavement and also the hardships of women. As we heard in that poem, "Bury Me in a Free Land." She was also an excellent business person as well. She knew the value and the worth of having her books be available for sale at her appearances, for offering ways that people could buy a little bit of a bit of poetry or a bit of a reading or so on. And while speaking in Ohio, she met the man who became her husband, Fenton Harper. He was a widower with three children, and they married in 1860. And she used her money to help buy a farm and settle in with the family to help raise the three children from his previous marriage and to welcome a baby of their own. But sadly, 4 years after they married, he died, leaving her with a mountain of debt of which she was unaware. And the creditors came and took everything. And she said in her address in 1866, she describes it this way. She said, my husband died suddenly, leaving me a widow with four children, one of my own and the other's stepchildren. She said, I tried to keep the children together, but my husband died in debt. And before he had been in his grave 3 months, the administrators came, had swept the very milk crocks and wash tubs from my hands. I was a farmer's wife and made butter for the market, but what could I do when they had swept it all away? They left me with one thing, a looking glass. She said, had I died instead of my husband, how different would be the result? By this time, he would have had another wife, it is likely, and no administrator would have gone to his house, broken up his home, sold his bed, and taken away his means of support. If she had been a man, she would have married again and received the grace to continue to manage her debts. But as a woman, she had no protection. As she said, justice is not fulfilled so long as women is unequal before the law. And that led her to further pursue rights for women. And so with baby in tow, she resumed speaking, the job she could do as well as was called to do in order to support herself. And after the end of the Civil War, she turned to the right to vote, along with the empowerment of women, along with the empowerment of Black women. I want to offer an excerpt from her speech in 1866, where she was up there speaking with Elizabeth Cady Stanton and Susan B. Anthony and more. And she says, she just lays it out. We are all bound up together in one great bundle of humanity, and society cannot trample on the weakest and feeblest members without receiving a curse on its own soul. She said, you tried that in the case of the Negro. You pressed him down for 2 centuries, and in so doing, you crippled the moral strength and paralyzed the spiritual energies of the white men of the country. When the hands of the Black are fettered, white men were deprived of the liberty of speech and the freedom of the press. Society cannot afford to neglect the enlightenment of any class of its members. She goes on to say, I do not believe that giving women the ballot is immediately going to cure all the ills of life. I do not believe that white women are dewdrops just exhaled from the skies. You can imagine that moment there, right? Wait a minute. The purity of white women called into question, my goodness. Mm-hmm. She said, I think that like men, they may be divided into classes, the good, the bad, and the indifferent. You white people, white women speak here of rights. I speak of wrongs. I, as a colored woman, have had in this country an education which has made me feel like I were in the situation of Ishmael. My hand against every man and every man's hand against me. Let me go tomorrow morning and take my seat in one of your streetcars in New York, and the conductor will put up his hand and stop the car rather than let me ride. And she's more specifically calls out the white women, because Harper really understood their social power and influence. She said, "Talk of giving women the ballot box? Go on. It is a normal school, and the white women of this country need it. While there exists this brutal element in society which tramples upon the feeble and treads down the weak, I tell you that if there is any class of people who need to be lifted out of their erring nothings and selfishness, it is the white women of America." Yes, she offered that message in front of two of the most noted white suffragettes in history. And she was fearless and clear in her path. But I want to pause for a moment here. Does this sound familiar? The challenge and the accountability and the responsibility being offered up to say, how are you doing with this measure as well? How is any one of us meeting that challenge? Where does what she says land 150 years later? More. How would we measure today against that day? Now, Frances Harper did not remain in the relative safety of the North in her effort. She, in fact, went south. She, in fact, went south while the Ku Klux Klan is forming, while people are destroying the lives of African Americans in an effort to exert power and control and take away wealth and take away the functionalness of any vote, whatever had been granted. And there she was, going as deep as she could to speak to the people, especially women who had been enslaved, who had been emancipated, but still lived, most of them, in the same shacks in which they had been enslaved. And remarkably, she was able to do this traveling and this speaking and not know harm. In the last half of the 1800s, she navigates the efforts to participate in securing the 15th Amendment that ensures the vote for Black men. But she also, this was a major split in the efforts of the time for the suffragettes and advocates for the vote. Harper, in this moment, she does not begrudge the men who got the vote before the Black women, because she understands the value, for her, she understands the value of the vote. And she simply continues to work for the rights for all women, because she understands the level of injustice in our society based on gender, and she understands the value of the vote. She has a poem that's out there where she belittles a man for selling his vote for the sake of some food. For Harper, the vote is too precious, even if it means to fill an empty stomach. She doesn't let anyone off the hook, and she is still able to speak and be heard. In our time, we use the word intersectionality, thanks to Dr. Kimberly Crenshaw, who first coined it in 1989. intersectionality speaks to the overlapping experience of gender and race and class and more marginalized identities that cannot be separated from one another. Our identity and our location are deeply and thoroughly intertwined. Frances Harper spoke to it from the various early days of her life. Her experience of injustice as a woman, as an African American in the United States, in levels of both wealth and poverty, fighting for a voice and a vote. And bound up, she saw this, bound up with politics and power and access and religion among so many forces. But I want to offer that Harper does not let the church off the hook either, which is the last takeaway for this moment. In that time, as in many ways our time, but certainly in that time more than now, social justice and religion were not separate conversations. As she heard in the words from her 1866 speech, she is calling on the moral and spiritual health of the society. The moral call was a Christian call. She learned about faith as an early age and as an adult in her AME congregation and then later in the Unitarian congregations. She was a member in Philadelphia, and she participated in both worlds. She knew both worlds well, the Black church and the white church. At the time, the Bible was used to defend the enslavement of people and justify the subservience of others to whites. Frances Harper brought this out in her novel from 1892. Kenny Wiley, from the writer in the UU World, talks about this, that Harper's 1892 novel, Iola Leroy, or Shadows Uplifted, which may have been the best-selling novel by an African-American before the 20th century, explores the Black title character's decision to forego passing as white and work to fight to end slavery and obtain civil rights. Through Harper's characters, Iola Leroy issues the call for religious persons to struggle, to join the struggle for freedom. And Iola asks her mother in the novel, "Are these people Christians who made the laws which are reducing us to slavery? If this is Christianity, I hate and despise it." Iola's mother responds, "I have not learned Christianity from them. I have learned it at the foot of the cross and from the New Testament." Unitarian Lydia Maria Child pointed out in 1833, "Christianity expressly teaches us to love our neighbors as ourselves. This shows how dangerous it is, even for the best of us, to become accustomed to what is wrong." So Harper was not alone in being amongst the voices to say, becoming comfortable with injustice is not okay. And as a church, as people of faith, in whatever faith, we must keep returning to that original call and value that we are to be loving one another equally. In our time, Dr. King has called us to be maladjusted. So too does Harper. At this point, the arc of the universe, how are we doing? How is the liberal church doing, and how shall we remain in true to our moment? The work goes on, and we cannot adjust and succumb. I bring forth this story about Frances Harper on the last Sunday of Black History Month with an eye towards Women's History Month next month, but we know this is not history. This is the work. And we listen to these people of our past to call us forth into the future, to remind us of what we must keep doing. Harper died in 1911 at the age of 85. Her funeral was at the First Unitarian Church in Philadelphia. She offered her gifts, her privilege as an educated antebellum African-American woman, to raise the question of race, gender, class, theology, and the vote in one of the most important critical centuries of our human history. We are learning to remember her again, as we did, as they did in 2016, by including her in the National Museum of African American History and Culture. Engraved at that museum are the closing thoughts of her poem, "Bury Me in a Free Land." "I ask no monument, proud and high, to arrest the gaze of passerby. All that my yearning spirit craves is bury me not in a land of slaves." Let us take up this request, this call, and take up our part in the bending of that arc. Amen. Please rise in body or spirit and join me for our closing hymn, number 118, "This Little Light of Mine." We listen once and sing through the verses. Like the flame of the chalice, may the flame of our hearts burn, remaining unextinguished. May it ignite our energies, our drive, our resolve to dream, to build, to live into the world. Live into the world in the good which exists for now only in our imaginings. Reverend Kimberly Quinn Johnson reminds us that we are the ones we have been waiting for. We are not perfect, but we are perfectly fitted for this day. We are not without fault, but we can be honest to face our past as we chart a new future. We are the ones we have been waiting for. May we be bold and courageous as we go forth. May we have faith in a future that is not yet known, for we are the ones who might make it happen. Our worship is ended. Let our service begin. Thank you.
Thank you.